It's just wonderful. It's amazing. Like, it's just blown me away. It gives people the freedom to choose to do this.
The Victorian Supreme Court today is setting a significant precedent, granting families of abuse victims the right to sue for their suffering.
It's a big win for everyone associated with abuse survivors. This opens the door, it just opens the door to claims by relatives of abuse survivors.
In 2017, Cardinal George Pell was charged with child sex offences over the alleged abuse of two choir boys in 1996, one of whom died of an accidental drug overdose in 2014.
Even today, there's not a day that I don't think of him. I don't think of what's happened.
Pell maintained his innocence, and after multiple trials and multiple appeals, he was acquitted of all charges in 2020. But the father of the deceased boy has filed a civil suit seeking damages for the nervous shock experienced upon learning of the allegations.
I have basically had several heart attacks. I've had anxiety issues. I've had depression issues.
Lawyers for Pell and the church argued that only the primary victim had the right to sue. The judge found otherwise.
This will stop the church from doing this in the future because it costs them a lot of money, whereas before it didn't.
But while the father's been granted the right to fight for justice, the fight itself is far from won.
He now has other legal hurdles. He's got to prove the fact of the abuse. He's got to establish that he was owed a duty of care by the church. This doesn't open the floodgates. What it does is it removes the barrier to suing.
Well, Julian Burnside QC is acting for the father and joins us now. Julian, what was your reaction to the justice's decision today?
I was very pleased, but not hugely surprised.
Right,
and have you... you tend to believe your own arguments.
Yes, I'm sure. Have you spoken to your client today? How's he feeling?
I've never actually met him or spoken to him.
Right.
And I don't know his true name. Don't need to, probably the answer.
Is it quite common to not know before you take on a case about who the person is?
It's not common for a litigant to have only a pseudonym, but it's not uncommon not to meet the client before you go to court.
It is a fascinating case that you're looking at here, but I gather the outcome of this, a lot of it hinges on something called the Ellis defence. Can you explain for us, Julian, in layman's terms, exactly what that is?
OK. If a proposed defendant is not incorporated, that is to say it's not a company like the Roman Catholic Diocese, then it can plead that it's not liable because it isn't incorporated.
Does this open the floodgates for the families of other victims or survivors? Because in the past, hasn't it been that if a perpetrator dies, the case dies with it?
It means that the party with the relevant assets is liable. But in this case, it's unusual because the point of contention in this case was that the case couldn't be brought by the parent of a victim of sexual abuse.
So, Julian, what now? What's next for your client?
What next is a trial in which he will need to prove that the son was sexually abused by Cardinal Pell and that he, the father, did not know about it until years later when the son died of a heroin overdose and that he suffered shock as a result.
It is just so incredibly tragic, Julian. We appreciate you talking us through it tonight. We'll obviously be watching closely, and thanks so much for your time.
Thank you.